fought, but you were just too weak. So you lost all the things.
Here, Jeremiah was called to be a prophet before he was even born. We learn that in chapter 1. And here is being commissioned and given exactly what the Lord wants him to do. This is really his first assignment. This is what the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, says. Correct your ways and your deeds, and I will allow you to live in this place. Do not trust deceitful words, chanting, "This is the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord." Instead, if you really change your ways and your actions, if you act justly toward one another, if you no longer oppress the alien, the fatherless, and the widow, and no longer shed innocent blood in this place or follow other gods, bringing harm on yourselves, I will allow you to live in this place. The land I gave to your ancestors forever and ever. But look, you keep trusting in deceitful words that cannot help. Do you steal? Do you murder? Do you commit adultery and swear falsely and burn incense to Baal and follow other gods? That's half of the Ten Commandments there that they were breaking. Follow after other gods you've not known? Then do you come and stand before me in this house called by my name and insist we are safe? As a result of all these detestable acts, has this house which is called by my name become a den of robbers in your view? Yes, I too have seen it. This is the Lord's declaration. But return to my place, which was at Shiloh. In other words, look back. Remember what I did in Shiloh. In fact, you can put a little note there. 1 Samuel 4 will tell you all about what happened at Shiloh, where I made my name dwell at first. See what I did because of the evil of my people Israel. Now, because you've done all these things, this is the Lord's declaration, and because I've spoken to you in time and time again, but you wouldn't listen, I've called you, but you wouldn't answer. What I did to Shiloh, I will do to the house that is called by my name, the house in which you trust, the place I gave you and your ancestors. I will drive you from my presence, just as I drove out all your brothers, all the descendants of Ephraim. Would you pray with me this morning? Lord God, I pray that you'd open our ears, open our hearts, open our minds to what you want to say to us. Lord God, I pray that this message from your word would convict and inspire and change somebody. Lord, help us to listen to you. Help us to listen to what your Holy Spirit is speaking to us today. Change us. Bring us back to where you want us to be. Lord, I pray for our country to turn back. Pray for the church to turn back. I pray for our church and churches like ours who stand on your word. But Lord, so many times Christians show up for church, but that's about it. Lord, help us never to be guilty of engaging in worthless worship. Lord, help us to invest our lives as we start a brand new year. Help us to be reminded of the fact that the things that really matter in life at the end of the year and at the beginning of the year, they're on our mind. Our kids, our families, our country, souls, your church. Lord, I pray that you bless Kingsland Baptist Church as we start a new year together, especially on this special week where we start a fantastic, exciting week of outreach through upper basketball. Lord, I pray for this Saturday for us to have a wonderful, wonderful day as we start and we have our first games. Lord, I pray that souls would be saved through Upward. Lord, I pray that folks would come to Kingsland because of Upward. I pray that families would be put back together because of our outreach to our community. Lord, I thank you for each of the 133 kids that are signed up, the cheerleaders, the basketball players. I thank you for each of the coaches. Lord, I pray that you would bless everyone who's involved, the referees, the ones helping in the cafe. Lord, help us to reach out to our community through Upward basketball. And Lord, help us when we lead them to Christ, when we show them the way, Lord, help us to take them by the hand and disciple them. Help us to be honest about what the Christian life really is. Help us to be forthright about what your word says about how we should live our lives. Help us to worship you in spirit and in truth, and help us to worship you each and every day, passionately. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Now, let's go back to Jeremiah, back to his time. The people of Judah were half-hearted in their worship. They were half-hearted in their devotion to the Lord. They were involved in various forms of wickedness, and they didn't even seem to be ashamed about it. Even though they were living in sin, they felt comfortable coming to the temple and worshiping. They viewed God's temple as something like a good luck charm. They thought that the temple building was almost magical. in protecting them. As long as they had God in the temple, they could do whatever they wanted and kind of show up there. Their worship was worthless because it was insincere and misguided. They presumed too much, and they took God's mercy and his grace for granted. Because of their coldness and their apathy towards the things of God, they didn't even realize they were in imminent danger. And when you think about it, sometimes people in the most danger are completely blind to it. That was Israel. That was Judah. Jeremiah was sent to warn them and help them make a turnaround. And you can imagine that they just welcomed him with open arms, right? Of course not. They hated him. They did not appreciate him or take his warning seriously. This was Jeremiah's first sermon, and it set the tone for his relationship with Judah from that point forward. You know, they call him the weeping prophet. That's because he suffered miserably. And not only did he suffer miserably, his people suffered terribly. And he knew how bad they were suffering. And God told him, they're not going to listen to you, Jeremiah. They're not going to hear you. He knew that they would suffer even more than he did. And he lived to see some of his prophecies fulfilled. Jerusalem was captured. The temple was destroyed. The people were taken into captivity because they turned their back on God. They refused to repent. They trusted in their wealth, in their military, in their warped form of religion, rather than trusting in God Almighty. Now, who does that sound like? They trusted in their wealth, their military, and their religion, their form of religion. And it cost them everything. You know, today the church can learn so much from Jeremiah's prophecy. Our culture has declined morally in a major, major way, similarly to the way they did in ancient Israel. I brought with me some proof of that, if I can find it. Well, I guess one example would be, out of all the people in the whole wide world, the mayor of New York City could have invited to put the ball down with him last night. Who'd he pick? Lady Gaga. That is a frightening sign of where our culture is. A few examples of recent intolerance towards Christianity. The Supreme Court determined to exclude anyone who prays in Jesus' name from a rotation of officials who opened in city business meetings in prayer. The removal of the United States military chaplain Gordon Klingland Schmidt over the issue of praying in Jesus' name. UCLA prohibited a graduate student from thanking her Lord and Savior Jesus Christ during her graduation speech. That was prohibited. Colleges making special accommodation for foot baths in Muslims' prayer rooms, while a Muslim group membership may be suspended or revoked for 57 reasons, including but not limited to unbecoming behavior, insubordination, or inactivity. But at the same time denying Christian groups its officers and voting members to agree with Christian beliefs. The Christian groups are being put out of existence because they're saying that they're making anybody that wants to join the Christian group agree to the Christian beliefs, and that's intolerance, so they're putting them out of business. We've become so tolerant that we tolerate everything but Christianity. A San Diego elementary school created an extra recess period to allow 100 Muslim students to pray, while at the same time, a federal judge upheld a Knoxville, Kentucky Bible Belt, a Knoxville, Kentucky jury's decision that a public school should prohibit its fifth grade Christian students from studying and discussing their Bibles during recess. So how far have we fallen? How different are we than them? We're warned by the words of Jesus, unless you repent, you're going to perish. America. Unless we repent, we will perish as a country. How about the church? Every Sunday, millions of Christians flood into churches, thousands and thousands of churches that are sprinkled across our land. But how many of those men and women and children are seriously pursuing Christ and sharing his love with others? And how many of those churches are seriously dedicated to the Word of God? God is not interested in dead, lifeless, worthless worship. And it's easy, it's so easy to grow casual or even cold. God knows your heart, ladies and gentlemen. He knows mine. And he knows we struggle. I wonder how many people struggled in 2011. If you were real honest, if we were just real genuine, transparent, we'd say, man, it was a rough year. Difficult year. God knows your heart. God knows you're discouraged. God knows the difficult things you're going through. But he expects red-hot worship in the good times and the bad. The Lord gives, the Lord takes away. Either way, blessed be the name of the Lord. And he deserves so much more than cold, dead, apathetic worship. He's worthy of our praise every single day. And you know, we live in a culture that will mock that. If you live that out, what I'm talking about, if you live that way, they're going to mock you. And example numero uno, and I bet it's on your mind, it may be, it is on mine, is this guy Tim Tebow. Bill Maher blasphemed God, put out the most vile information, words, about this young man who's not perfect. He's not the Messiah. He's just a football player. He's a good guy that loves Jesus, and he won't stop talking about it. Heaven forbid. He won't stop talking about Jesus. See, what they would rather is to see him coming in and out of nightclubs. What they'd rather is to see him completely blow his testimony. What they'd rather is to see him have a bunch of kids from a bunch of different women and do a bunch of different drugs. That would be so much better. Thank God for someone who's willing to stand up. What they'd rather, I saw a supposedly Christian athlete speaking publicly, and he used a bad word. That's what they'd rather. They'd rather see that from Tim Tebow. Instead, he praises his Lord and Savior Jesus Christ every chance he gets. When he wins, when he loses, and they mock that. They make fun of that. Henry David Thoreau said this: the more we know about the ancients, the more we find that they were like the moderns. Isn't that true? We're weak, we're feeble, we're flesh and blood. We're a lot like ancient Judah. So what can we learn from what Jeremiah had to say in his sermon, in his preparation for the sermon? I want to offer four ideas, four suggestions that we can learn from what the Lord gave Jeremiah. Number one is this: we are expected to live out God's word. We are expected, if you're a follower of Christ, you are expected to live out God's word. We have Christian liberty. We have freedom. What that means is you have the freedom to do the right thing. You have been enabled by the presence of the Holy Spirit living in you to do the right thing, to do that which is right. We're expected to live out God's word and to share it with others. Look back at the text. This is the word of the Lord in verse 1 that came to Jeremiah from the Lord. Stand at the gate of the house of the Lord, and there call out his word. Hear the word of the Lord, all you people of Judah who enter the house, these gates, through these gates, to worship the Lord. God instructed Jeremiah to stand in the gate and to speak up for him. And that's exactly what we've been called to do. I thank God for the young people that have come up through our ministry over the years, and even some adults who God has called into full-time vocational ministry, missionaries, pastors, assistant pastors, worship leaders, youth leaders. It's awesome to see some of the ones that have come up through our ministry at Kingsland. Think of Robert Chapman, who's preaching this morning in South Carolina, who came up, was led to Christ here, and grew and called into ministry here at Kingsland. That's an awesome thing. And Sean Hypes and so many others. Holly Simmons and others who God has anointed, God has put a special call on their lives. I can remember when God did that in my life, just like he did with Jeremiah. And it's life-changing. It's awesome. But here's the thing. You don't have to be called to be a full-time, paid pastoral staff member or missionary for this to apply to you. This applies to you if you're a follower of Christ. If you're a plumber, if you're a lawyer, if you're a doctor, if you're a business person, whatever you are, salesman, we are all expected to live out God's word and to share it. Stand and call out his word. Be true to your convictions at work. Be true to your convictions at school, at the club, at the gym, wherever you go. Be ready to share your faith and pray for opportunities to communicate the gospel each and every day, just like Jeremiah was told to do. And don't always expect a pat on the back. Don't always expect someone to say, well, thank you very much. They may say that. They may say, get out of my face. Either way, stand up for what you believe in. Live it out and share it with others. And in 2012, I can hardly even say it. I'm sure we'll write it wrong on our checks and everything else for a while. And in 2012, why don't you resolve to worship the Lord by living for him, not just singing for him, living for him, not just talking the talk, but living it. And after you live it, share it. Second lesson from this text. Here it is. Our methods often change, but the message never does. Our methods often change. I mean, think about Jeremiah in a robe, maybe even a turban, using a scroll. Our methods have changed tremendously since Jeremiah's day. But our message never changes. Our message is this: repent and trust God. And that was the message in the early church. That was the message in the Old Testament. It's been the same message all along. He's in here, he says, change your ways. Look at verse 3. This is what the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, says. Correct your ways and your deeds, and I will allow you to live in this place. Do not trust deceitful words, chanting, this is the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, some rhythmic, cheering chant thing. Don't do that. If you really change your ways and your actions, that's the beginning of verse 5. What is he saying? Change your ways. Repent. Turn around. Stop it. Understand there are things that God calls sin that should not be involved in a Christian's life. Get those things out of your life. And this is not a bully pulpit or some sort of priestly sermon where I have not sinned. Listen, we've all sinned. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. Acknowledge it. That's how you got saved, isn't it? When you acknowledge that was a sin. That was a wrong thing in my life. I repent of that. And you're born again. Repent. That's our message to a lost world. Repent. Identify sin for what it really is and turn around away from it. Warren Wiersbe said, any theology that minimizes God's holiness and tolerates people's deliberate sinfulness is a false theology. Isn't that true? We can't just have a feel good, everybody's okay. They're not okay. Our culture's not okay. Our country's not okay. The church is not okay. Our methods will change, but our message never changed. Repent. Jeremiah told the people to repent and trust God alone. Now, I want to talk about new methodology that we've embraced over the last few years. When you think about it, you know, this upward thing. I'm so excited about upward this week. Pray for upward. Pray for upward. Pray for the kids. That's something we've only been doing that 6 years. Why? Why do we do that? Because we want to reach kids and families. Awana, we're on maybe 15 years of that. That's something still in a 106-year-old church, that's relatively new. We have screens up here today. I mean, can you imagine putting up screens in a church 30 years ago? They'd have thought you were out of your mind. Yeah, it was horrible. Don't do that, you know. We have new instruments on stage. We have Operation Chesterfield that we're even going to make some interesting changes for that here in a few months. Our van ministry, our bus ministry, our gym is just 5 years old, our Family Life Center. Today is a special day. At the end of our service, we're going to burn the note on that Family Life Center. Thank God. It's ours. He gave it to us. And our Hispanic church, that's new. It's a couple years old. They reached 100 people just a few weeks ago at Nueva Esperanza. Our block parties, so many things that we're trying. Why? Because we're willing to try whatever it takes to reach people where they are. And most of it involves us getting out of the walls of this church and sharing the gospel with others. Think back to 2011 and some of the things that were new and fresh and cool at Kingsland. We have a new foyer in the back. Looks great. Our team just did a wonderful job with that, a new welcome center. We revitalized our preschool hall. It looks cool. It's neat. It's exciting. It's fresh. We have a new soundboard upstairs. You wouldn't know it. Probably don't even care or appreciate it, but we needed it. The other one was ruined. And today, right now, this week, we put in a new soundboard. We tried Truth Project last spring, last winter. Why do we try new things? Why? Well, because we're willing to be flexible. We're willing to try new things to reach people where they are. In 2012, we have work to do, folks. We have a lot of work to do in 2012. We have a $30,000 roof to put on the building, on the education building. We're going to do here shortly, here in 2012. We're going to revitalize Share Hall this coming year. We have boilers, air conditioner units, roofs. None of that is really glamorous or cool. You don't really see them necessarily. But believe me, in Jeremiah's day, if people came to church and there was no AC, that was not a problem. They just fanned or whatever they had to do. It's not going to work now, is it? On January 15th, we're starting KBC orientation. I hope that if you'd like more information about our church, you'll come to that. If you want to join our church, you need to go through our new members class, our orientation class, here in 2 Sundays. In March, we're going to kick off a new Bible study fellowship class for young couples. We are doing whatever we can to reach whoever we can. Our methodology changes, but our message never does. Third lesson from this text, God always blesses obedience. God always blesses obedience. So we stopped in verse 5, and that's what we see here in verse 5. Instead, if you really change your ways and your actions, if you act justly toward one another, do right, treat each other right, if you no longer oppress the alien, taking advantage of those weaker than you, the fatherless and the widow, and no longer shed innocent blood in this place or follow other gods, bringing harm on yourselves. Instead, if you do those, if you'll stop doing those things, I will allow you to live in this place, the land I gave you to your ancestors forever. I will allow you to live in this place. That sounds a little bit to me like John 10:10, where Jesus said, I will give you life, and that more abundantly, life to the fullest. God blesses obedience. Blessings were promised for those who obeyed Jeremiah's writings. God spoke to Jeremiah. Jeremiah spoke to the people, and they didn't listen, unfortunately. But the promise for blessing was there nonetheless. And I thought this week about a buddy of mine who I grew up with, who's so blessed. His name's Steve. Grew up with Steve. We played Little League together and went to school together, graduated, I think, the same year. That's 20 years ago. But Steve today, and he loved Jesus when he was a kid. He stood for Christ as a young man. Today, Steve is a pastor in my hometown, Calvert County, Maryland. And Steve has a wonderful wife, wonderful kids, nice, beautiful church home. And he has been so blessed, not because he's such a good guy, but because God blesses people who serve him, who listen to him, who build their life. And he's just one example. Does that mean nothing bad's ever going to happen to Steve? Of course not. Bad things already have happened to my buddy Steve. But he never had to suffer through them alone. He always had the Lord right there with him, just like each and every one of us has had during the difficult times in our lives. God blesses obedience. God always blesses obedience. I want to spend a minute talking about finances, financial obedience. God blesses your obedience when it comes to tithing, when it comes to giving sacrificially for those in need, serving in a ministry, listening to the Holy Spirit, abstaining from sin. God blesses you when you do the right thing. And in 2012, we're going to rely on the Lord 100% as a church. Just like over the past 106 years. Some years have been better than others. But we've always relied on the Lord. And I challenge you to put your faith in God, especially when it comes to your finances. Give more than you've ever given before. If you've never tithed, start tithing. Take the step of faith in 2012. We're going to vote in a budget at the end of this service. We're going to present it. It's already been presented. We're going to vote on it. I assume we're probably going to vote it in for 2012, a faith budget. A ministry investment plan where we have prayed over and planned for the coming year as best we could. And we know that God could change things, God could add things, God could take things away. We realize that. It's in God's hands, and we trust the Lord for that. But I wanted to share some of the things with you, just a half dozen of the things we're thinking about in the coming year, that you will be, when you give, when you tithe, when you sacrifice, some of the things you're going to be supporting, where God is using this church to make a profound impact in our world through our finances. We're going to invest $60,000 next year. $60,000 into the cooperative program. What is that? Well, that supports our missionaries in North America, our international missionaries, our seminaries, the Religious and Ethics Commission. $60,000 out of our tithes and offerings. Now, that's not including Lottie Moon, which supports the international missionaries. We're within about 10,000 of our goal right now. It's not too late to give. Please, let's hit that goal. It's not including Annie Armstrong, which all goes to North America, and the international offering all goes to international. But within our budget is $60,000 allocated for missions. Another $3,000 allocated for local benevolence. That's people in our area that need help, and you don't have to look far to realize there's a lot of people around us that need help. That's what your tithes and offerings are going to support, among so many other things. We have about $4,200 planned for mission projects and the Mission Foundation together. Now, what is that? That's when we go out and we serve people on mission trips, either locally or I guess down the road in America, or even international mission trips, that helps subsidize people going on mission trips. Our Family Life Center across the street is going to cost us $30,000 to operate. That's a big number. That's a scary number. Electric, heat, all of it. $30,000. to maintain our family life center. Thank God it's paid off. But we're gonna have to, you know, and to have that tool over there that we've really just scratched the surface on using. There's so many more things we could do with our family life center. I told you earlier we're gonna revitalize Share Hall. We have about $20,000 budgeted to use that facility. That already there's a lot more we could do with Share Hall. But every week in Share Hall, the Hispanic church is meeting. Every week, the youth have grown to the point where they use Share Hall on Wednesday nights. And sometimes they have 80, 90 students that we're reaching. $9,000. If you take our block parties and our Operation Chesterfield money, it's about $9,000 we're going to spend on that, on Operation Chesterfield and our two block parties. We have men's ministry, women's ministry, youth ministry, children's ministry, preschool ministry. The list goes on and on and on. And we're talking dollars and cents and finances. I know that's not extremely exciting, but every single thing we do has a price tag to it. There's nothing. Try driving down the road without putting a price tag to it. You can't. Everything you're wearing costs money. Everything you eat costs money. Everything we do. I hope that you will allow God to bless you like never before in the coming year and give like never before. And the application is direct from point number three here. Participate in it and pray for it. This is your church. We're not stagnant. We're not waiting around. We are actively endeavoring to reach men and women, to disciple them, to reach teenagers and children and preschoolers, to disciple them. Participate in it. If you're not already in a ministry or if you're involved in something that is very low sacrifice, low time commitment, don't quit that. But it's okay to add. It's okay to have two ministries, maybe three. Of course, we always think of the ones that have a half dozen different ministries that you shouldn't be dragged down carrying the load for so many others who don't step up. But I'd ask you to evaluate yourself as you start into the new year. Evaluate your Bible study fellowship participation. Every Sunday morning at 9:30, your kids need to be in Bible study. You need to be in Bible study. It's good for you to study the Word of God in a small group, to pray together, to share each other's needs, to help each other when you're sick, to participate. Participate in it and pay for it. This budget will be presented in a few minutes. And I hope you have a copy of it. I emailed it out to everybody that gets our email. It's in the lobby there. I hope that you'll participate in it, and I hope that you'll pay for it. Lastly, number four, God always disciplines disobedience. God always disciplines disobedience. He always blesses obedience, but he always disciplines disobedience. Look at verse 8. But look, you keep trusting in deceitful words that cannot help. Stop. Deceitful words that cannot help. Can I submit to you, teenagers, that it, just about anything you see on MTV is deceitful words that cannot help. If you are more dedicated to Ellen than you are to your quiet time, I'm not saying everything is incorrect there, but there's going to be enough deceit. It's not going to help you very much. How about Hollywood? How about our liberal media? Listen, don't trust in deceitful words that cannot help. Do you steal? Do you murder? Do you commit adultery? Swear falsely? Do you burn incense to Baal? I don't want to go through each one of these, but man, this stuff is real in the church. Jesus said, don't hate. To hate someone is the same as to murder them. How about in our country, our national scandal, our national sin, abortion? Do you murder? Yeah, the United States murders. Do you commit adultery? Pornography is a multi-billion dollar industry. You swear falsely? Listen, as the people of God, let's be people of our word. When you shake your hand, when you say something, follow through on it. Make a commitment and keep it. Do you burn incense to Baal and follow other gods? I just think of the gods of this age, the god of the American dream, the god of the big house will make me happy, the god of Hollywood, the god, all these gods that are swirling around in our heart is tempted to trust them. Understand that God always disciplines disobedience. He goes on to say, verse 10, then you come and stand before me in this house called by my name and insist, we're safe. As a result, you're free to continue doing all these detestable acts. He's saying, no, you're not. You can't live that way and then come to God's house and act like everything's okay. It's not okay. Has this house, which is called by my name, become a den of robbers in your view? Yes, I too have seen it. This is the Lord's declaration. But return. Think back to my place, which was at Shiloh. And I'm not going to say a whole lot about that, but remember Eli and his sons? They were in Shiloh. And Eli had his awful sons that were with the women and stealing the money and desecrating the sacrifices. And they took the Ark of the Covenant off to war, and they thought, well, that's our good luck charm. We're good to go with the Ark of the Covenant. And what happened? They died. And Samuel, when he heard about his sons dying and the Ark of the Covenant being taken, he fell back and he died. He broke his neck and he died. That was all what happened at Shiloh. That's what it's referring to. Can't live that way and call ourselves worshipers of the Lord. No, God is just, and he always disciplines disobedience. We don't understand his timing. Sometimes we see people that are doing wrong and they're getting away with it seemingly. Man, write down Revelation 19. They're not going to get away with it. He's going to put his foot down. He's going to stamp out evil. The children of Israel ignored Jeremiah. They threw him into prison. They didn't want to hear it. They wouldn't listen. And eventually they got thrown into captivity into Babylon for 70 years. They were lost. And they were so lost that they didn't even realize their worship was a fraud until it was too late. They were too busy, too distracted, too proud, too defiant, too religious, too stubborn to listen. Would you pray with me? Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? And in an atmosphere of prayer, I just encourage you to listen to what the Holy Spirit's telling you. God expects us to live our faith, live out his word, and share it. I believe God expects us to change our methodology, to be creative, to be Holy Spirit-filled and Holy Spirit-led, sensitive. But the message really never changed. Repent. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior yet, that's really the message you need to hear. Repent. Repent. Turn away from your sin and turn to Jesus. Give your heart to Christ, the one who died for you, shed his blood, was buried, and rose from the grave, and said he's going to come back, and he's going to judge. If you need someone to pray with you about that, come forward during our invitation, and we'll have someone pray with you and lead you to Jesus. Isn't it wonderful to know that God always blesses obedience? When we plant seeds of obedience, he always brings in a crop of blessings. And he always curses disobedience. He disciplines us when we fail, just like any good, loving father would. So as New Testament believers, today, we don't have a physical temple. This church building is not a temple. It's simply a building that is consecrated for kingdom purposes. If you're saved, then you are the church, and your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Be careful what you do with your body, teenagers. Be careful what you do, what you put on your body, how you mark up your body. Be careful. Do not intentionally hurt or defile your temple. Keep your temple fit and trim and healthy. And make sure above all else that you make your number one life's goal. And I challenge you to make this your New Year's resolution. If you haven't already made one, make this: to worship the Lord your God from a pure heart, from a sincere heart. Refuse to live one way during the week and then put on a mask on Sundays. And if you're convicted about that, spend some time with the Lord right now. Take it to the Lord. He desires that we lovingly share the good news every chance we get. He's pleased when we implement new methods to share the gospel message that never changes. He still blesses our obedience, and he still disciplines us when we're disobedient. He is truly great. And today we're going to sing How Great Thou Art. Just as an opportunity to worship the Lord in song again. He's not asking for perfection, folks. He's asking for a sincere heart that acknowledges when we mess up, deals with it, puts it under the blood. And because of his blood, he sees us as sanctified. He sees us as holy. Will you make a decision this year? This is going to be the year I worship the Lord passionately. My New Year's resolution: to be an authentic, passionate worshiper of Jesus Christ 7 days a week. As we sing, as we have this time of decision, I would encourage you to come forward if you want to join our church, if you want to request baptism, if you have a burden on your heart, come and pray. Just you and Jesus, if that's what you need to do. I would encourage the rest of us just to sing with all of our heart of what a great and awesome and powerful and mighty God we serve. Would you stand with me? God in heaven, you are great, and we praise your holy name today in spirit and in truth. How great thou art, Lord Jesus. Work in our lives today, we pray. Amen. Sing out. Seem a little weird or out of place, but don't let it. business at Kingsland is the business of souls. Our goal is to connect people with Jesus Christ. Everything we do revolves around that. For those that are already connected to Christ, we want to help them get more connected to Christ. For those who don't know Jesus, we want to connect them with Jesus by seeing them born again. And today, we have had just a wonderful day. And Kent Safewright has come forward this morning, and he's requested membership in our church to become part of that vision. And I'm excited about that. So, Kent, thank you for coming forward today. Kent and so many others will start our KBC orientation class in 2 Sundays, January 15th, 9:30. I hope that you will come and find out more during that time. Right now, I'm going to call our church into business. We have some cool business to do. I got my pot here. We'll show you about that in a second. But before we do that, I want to bring up our chairman of our finance committee, Carl Wilson, who's going to come and have us make the motion to put this 2012 faith budget in place. So come on up, Carl.
The Budget and Finance Committee met in early October, and at that time we put together a faith budget for Kingsland Baptist Church for the year 2012. And this morning we will be voting on this budget without any further discussion. The budget was presented at the December 4th business meeting, and at that time any questions, concerns that you may have had with the budget were addressed at that time. So as I say, we'll have no further discussion on the budget. All we're going to do is vote yes or no. And so I move now that the faith budget as presented at the December 4th business meeting be approved for the year 2012.
All in favor, raise your right hand. Any opposed? None. All right, that's carried. Carl, if you'd stay up, and we're going to invite our treasurer, Don Philpott, to come to the stage. And I also want to invite, today's a neat day, the first day of the year. We have a former chairman of deacons as of yesterday, and we have a new chairman of deacons as of today. So I want to invite both of them to come to the stage, Ashton Brock and Greg Edmonds, who will be serving this coming year as our new chairman of deacons this year. Well, thank Ashton for the awesome job he did. Billy Davenport was his assistant, vice chairman. Thank you so much to all of our deacons for your faithfulness and your servant-heartedness. And thankful now that Greg will be our chairman this year, and Jeff Foley is our vice chairman of deacons for this coming year. So all these four up here, we have somebody to take a picture somewhere. All right, now, a few months ago, we paid off the Family Life Center. How cool is that? And we have the mortgage here we're going to burn, and we're going to try not to burn the whole house down in the process. So can we all step over this way so everybody can see it? And we've got an extinguisher. Who's going to hold the pot? Gonna hold the pot there, bro? All right. And let me see this thing. It was a lot of money, and God blessed us, and it's gone. So let's burn it and be done. Okay. All right, don't burn your hand there, Don. Here we go. Yep. There we go. All right. So it is officially and symbolically burn up and gone. Put your lighter back. Ooh, that's hot. That's getting out of control. Is that getting hot on your hands, Carl? Y'all can stay up here. Only God knows how many hundreds of thousands of dollars that we save by paying that thing off in just 6-7 years versus 15 or more years. We save hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars of interest, and we did it in 5 years. So that is a testimony to the giving heart of our people. Thank you, thank you, thank you for being such good givers. Ashton Brock, if you would dismiss our time today in prayer.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your many blessings this previous year and your mercy and your grace. We just look forward to this year for the mighty things that you're going to do here at this church. I pray, Father, that all of us will be faithful in service and in giving this year. Pray, Father, for our pastors and their families, for protection and that you would watch over them, Lord, give them patience and wisdom. And for Greg, as he takes over as chairman, Lord, I just pray the same for him and his family, Lord, that you would give him good health, wisdom, that you would protect him from anything that would hinder his ministry as chairman of the deacons this coming year. And Lord, again, I just thank you for your awesome blessings. I know, Lord, that there's many in this room that have probably had a difficult year. But Lord, you're always with us, and we thank you for that. We just ask you to go with us now. I ask this in Christ's name. Amen.
God bless you.
My name is Pat Fiordelise. I'm the pastor here at Kingsland Baptist Church, and I want to thank you for being with us for our video broadcast of our service. And thank you for watching. I hope that you enjoyed it, and I hope that you will get in contact with us if there's anything we can do to help you. Our phone number is 275-1285, and you can check us out on the web at kingslandbaptist.com. And we want you to know that we love you. A verse in Scripture that means a lot to me comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and it says that the love of Christ compels us, it constrains us, it motivates us. And that's really what we're all about at Kingsland, and that is connecting people with Christ, because the love of Christ compels us to do so. We've received his love, and now we want to share his love all over Chesterfield County. And maybe tonight you have questions about your spiritual destiny and whether or not you're on your way to heaven ultimately with your life. And I would encourage you to think about that, to pray about that, to talk to God about it. You see, Jesus Christ loves you. He died for you. He shed his blood for your sins. And the Bible says there's none righteous. No, not one. There's none who does good. There's none who seeks after God. So the truth about humanity is that we're born separated from Christ. We're born lost. And we're really born dead, spiritually speaking. And what we need to do is to be born again. That's what Jesus said. You must be born again. And he made that possible by dying on the cross for our sins, being buried, and raising from the grave 3 days later. And you know what? That can become a reality in your life. Tonight, if you want to invite Christ into your life, do that. Ask him to forgive you of your sins. Ask him to be your Lord and your Savior. And give your heart to Jesus. And what we're here to do is to help you, help introduce you to Christ, to connect you with Christ, and to help you grow. And that's why we have our television show every Friday night. And that's why we have services here at Kingsland every Sunday. We have Bible study at 9:30 every Sunday morning. And we have a worship service at 11 o'clock every Sunday morning. And we would love for you to come and sing and learn and grow in your faith. If there's anything we can ever do for you, contact us here at Kingsland, 275-1285. And we hope to see you soon. God bless you.
We were made to be courageous. We were made to lead the way. We could be the generation that finally breaks the chains. We were made to be courageous. We were made to be courageous. We were warriors on the front lines, standing unafraid. But now we're watchers on the sidelines while our families slip away. Where are you, men of courage? You were made for so much more. Let the pounding of our hearts cry, we will serve the Lord. We were made to be courageous, and we're taking back the fight. We were made to be courageous, and it starts with us tonight. The only way we'll ever stand is on our knees with lifted hands. Make us courageous. We were made to be courageous, and it starts with us tonight. The only way we'll ever
You were just too weak. So you lost all the things you tried to keep. Now you're on your knees. You're on your knees. But wait, yeah, everything can change in a moment's time. You don't have to be afraid, 'cause fear is just a lie. Open up your eyes, and he'll break. Not too late. Lift up your head, let the rain